My new ESP32 TV boards have arrived from PCBWay. There are a couple of problems with the board, which we'll cover next, but there's also a catastrophic error on the board that could have led to some really nasty consequences. So, quick quiz, can you see the problem? Is it A, the MOSFET is the wrong way round? B, the input capacitor is way too low? C, the NCP167 can't deliver enough power? Or D, something else that's really obvious? We'll come back to this towards the end of the video. Let me know in the comments if you get it right. My goal with this board was to get everything working. We've got audio output from the MAX98537, battery charging with the TP4056, an infrared receiver, and the biggest feature of all, super high-speed access to the SD card. Now this is the most exciting thing on the board. If it works, then we can load files onto our TV without needing to unplug the SD card. Now, it is already possible to access the SD card directly from our PC using the ESP32 in mass storage mode, but it's painfully slow. I did manage to get it up to 1 MB per second reading and writing, but it took a lot of hacking, and for me, it's still not fast enough, especially if you want to transfer large video files. So that's the big goal, high-speed SD card access over USB. To achieve this, I've added an additional IC, the USB2244. In theory, this should give us a transfer rate to the SD card of up to 35 megabytes per second. Now, this does of course depend on the SD card and how good our USB connection is. Testing the SD card I'm using, connected directly to my PC, I get 25 megabytes per second. So that's my target rate. If we can get close to that, I'm going to call it a win. So the big question is, does the new PCB actually work? Do we get the results I'm looking for? And initially, it was a big fat no. The board did absolutely nothing. We can't connect to the ESP32, and we can't connect to the SD card. What a disappointment, we're completely dead. When I made the board, I was concerned that the ESP32 and the USB2244 would not play nicely together. But I was hoping that the ESP32 would be able to use the USB connection when the USB2244 was held in reset mode. To ensure this, I put a pull-down resistor on the reset line. When it's in reset mode, all the pins are supposed to go into a high impedance state and not interfere with anything else. Looking at my schematic, I could see that I'd use GPIO 39 to control the reset line. As we discovered in our previous video, printing PCBs at home, this pin behaves weirdly when the ESP32 is in download mode. Both GPIO 39 and GPIO 40 are used for JTAG debugging, so you get all sorts of weird output on them. My initial suspicion is that this was stopping the USB2244 from going into reset, and that it was conflicting with the ESP32 on the USB lines. Measuring the voltage on the reset pin, I got 2.7 volts. To me, this felt like some kind of clock signal or a data line that is being toggled on and off. So I attacked my PCB and chopped through the trace, leaving just the pull-down resistor. The USB2244 should now definitely be in reset mode all the time. Sadly, this did nothing. I still couldn't connect to the ESP32. This completely stumped me, so I took the nuclear option and desoldered the USB2244 completely, leaving just the ESP32 module. And as expected, I could now connect to the ESP32 without any problems. So I tried the opposite. I took another board and desoldered the ESP32. Plugging this in, I now got an SD card appearing on my computer, which was great. The USB2244 was working, but also not great. The USB2244 should be held in reset mode via the pull-down resistor. It should not start up at all. Measuring the voltage on the reset pin, I still got 2.7 volts. What on earth is going on? There's nothing in the datasheet, but looking at some other similar ICs, I think there is an undocumented pull-up resistor on the reset line. Giving our measured voltage of 2.7 volts and the 100k pull-down resistor, this hidden pull-up resistor must be around 20k. Our 100k pull-down resistor is not going to do anything. So I took another board, thank goodness I ordered 5 assembled boards, and I soldered a 1k resistor across the existing pull-down resistor. And hey presto, the ESP32 sprang into life. I then tested out switching over from the ESP32 to the USB2244. I changed the two USB pins on the ESP32 to input and enabled the USB2244 by taking GPIO 39 high. And amazingly, my board transformed into a high-speed SD card. My proof of concept works. we can share the USB bus between the two chips and switch between them. All it took is one bodge resistor. But just how fast is our high-speed SD card? With the USB 2244 enabled, we can transfer files at around 21 megabytes per second. That's over 20 times faster than using the ESP32 directly. It's a massive improvement. What's more, we're close to what I was able to get when connecting the card to my Mac, so I'm happy with this performance. It's an amazing result. But what about the rest of the board? Do all the other peripherals work? The first thing I wanted to check was the display. On the back of the board, I've got a footprint for the FPC ribbon cable. The display has a completely non-standard pin pitch of 0.7. The only place that I've been able to find a connector with this pitch is on Alibaba, and I'm not sure I really need 100 of them, at least not yet. So we're going to have to solder it on. I've never soldered one of these flat cables before, but it seemed to work okay. I just tinned the pads, added plenty of flux, and then taped the cable in place with Kapton tape. This technique seemed to work okay. I kept the soldering iron on quite a low temperature and just ran it over each pad until the solder flowed. With my TV firmware loaded and adjusted for the new pins, we get a picture showing up, and with the speaker plugged in, we get sound coming out. The amplifier is all good.
My new ESP32 TV board.
What's more, this proves that the infrared receiver is also working. We've come quite a long way from our original prototype with our minimal dev board project. So, what's next? There are a couple of things that need improving. I'm very pleased with the sharing of the SD card between the USB 2244 and the ESP32. This seems to work nicely. It is possible to turn off the JTAG pins by burning an E-fuse on the ESP32 and holding GPIO3 high, but of course to do that, we need to be able to connect to the ESP32. A bit of a chicken and egg situation. We could use a different GPIO pin to fix this, but sharing the USB connection between the two ICs concerns me. It just feels a bit nasty and way too easy to get into a state where we can't talk to the ESP32 and our board is bricked. So I'm thinking of moving to having two USB sockets, one for the ESP32 and one for the USB 2244. With the ribbon cable working, I can lose this pin header, which gives me a bit more space on the board. I could even skip the USB socket for the ESP32 and just have a programming header for it. Another issue I found is that the module I'm using has 8 MB of PS RAM. Enabling this caused the board to crash as soon as I tried to use the SD card. The problem is, if we're using PS RAM, we're not allowed to use GPIO 35, GPIO 36 or GPIO 37. And of course, I used all three of these pins for my SD card connection. So I'll have to shuffle a few things around to avoid these pins and the JTAG pins. I'm also taking a look at a much cheaper IC for the SD card controller. There's a GL823 that is just 40 cents. That's 10 times cheaper than the USB 2244. And it doesn't need a crystal, which simplifies the circuit and reduces the BOM nicely. The docks for this IC are not great, so I'm going to create a test PCB first to see if it actually works. Now, I'm sure you're asking, what's the big issue? You promised us a potentially explosive error. Well, I'm not sure where this error crept in, and it's a bit of a silly one. I got it right in the previous board, but somehow this diode got moved to the wrong side of this MOSFET. This power control circuit is designed to switch between the USB power and battery power. When the USB is connected, the battery should be blocked, and when the USB is not connected, the battery should be used. It's a very clever circuit when it's done properly. With the current PCB, I've connected the USB 5V directly to the battery via this diode. This is definitely not what you're supposed to do, and it could have ended up in a very nasty situation. It's a good job I didn't test out the battery charging first before I noticed this. So I think that's probably the first thing to fix before I do anything else. While I'm working on that, you might enjoy this playlist of videos. You can see the journey we took to get to this video and what we might be doing next.